So good evening, everyone. It's a pleasure to welcome you to the ninth HMI Data AI and Society Seminar. I'd like to start by acknowledging the traditional custodians of country and pay my respects to their elders, past, present, and emerging. So tonight we have a speaker from the Max Planck Institute in Germany, who I've just found out is also heading on to the Indian Institute of Technology shortly, Avi Chakraborty. And he's going to be talking about incorporating fairness in two-sided online platforms. So Abhi, if you'd like to share your slides and take it away, please.
I'm going to present our work on incorporating fairness in two-sided online platforms. I am Abhi. I'm a postdoctoral researcher at the Max Planck Institute for Software Systems, which is located at Saarbrücken in Germany. Now, today, algorithms are being used to assist or replace human decision-making in several socially relevant domains, such as in banking, to determine whom to give loan, in employment, to filter and rank job applicants, in judiciary, to determine bail or jail decisions, and even in healthcare, to identify patients who need additional long-term care. But as all of you are aware, that along with several benefits, like scalability and ease of deployment of algorithmic decision-making algorithms, there are concerns about biases in algorithmic decisions in several domains. Such as in case of employment, Amazon had to scrape the AI recruiting tool it was developing after it showed bias against women. In healthcare, a recent science paper found that the healthcare algorithm, which is used across the United States, is biased against poorer social groups. And this is one example I think all of you are familiar with. ProPublica, an investigative journalism organization, they found that a tool called Compass, which is used for recidivism risk predictions in US judiciary, it is biased against African Americans. And the solution what people are trying to propose or come up with is to incorporate fairness in machine learning algorithms. This is in fact a very active area of research, as all of you are aware. Almost all the top 10 machine learning conferences these days have several papers on algorithmic fairness. And moreover, several conferences have come up which exclusively focus on research related to fairness in machine learning and other areas in general, like FACT or AIES. However, one point to note here is that existing works mostly focus on supervised classification setting, which relies on training data with objective ground truth. Now, what do I mean by this? Let's take the context of creditworthiness prediction. So essentially, the classification algorithm decides whom to give loan or what should be a credit score. And this relies on training data this training data consists of past decision records, where the training data essentially have the information whether some people have returned loan or defaulted on the loan payment. So these are kind of objective ground truth or some kind of factual information. Although this ground truth can be biased, but at least it relies on this objective ground truth to build the classification models. However, if we think beyond classification, in multiple learning systems today, the algorithm needs to account for subjective personal preferences. Such as if we think about search ranking, even in a web search, if I am a computer programmer, when I am typing for Python, I am looking for Python, the computer language. Whereas a wildlife enthusiast may be interested in Python, the snake, right? So it's like different people may have different preferences over the kind of search results they are looking for. And the same is true for recommendation, as well as when there is a matching system involved. The focus of my research has been to consider fairness in decision-making scenarios where we have to consider preferences of different users. Now, most specifically, I am interested in incorporating fairness in two-sided online platforms. And these are the platforms where you can divide the user group into two sides. Like on one hand, you have producers, and another hand, you have customers. Let's take the example of e-commerce, where you have sellers and buyers. In ride-hailing platforms like, say, Uber or Ola, you have drivers on one side and passengers on another side. In content streaming platforms like Spotify, YouTube, you have artists and listeners or viewers. And even in case of human resource matchmaking platform like LinkedIn or Monster.com, you have recruiters and then job seekers. Important thing to note here is that this both sides, producers and customers, may have preferences over the other side. Like some producers may have preference for some set of customers, whereas the customers may have preference for some set of producers. So the goal of this research is to fairly consider preferences of one or both sides while we try to develop search recommendation or matching systems. So far, we have tried to incorporate fairness in multiple different types of platform algorithms, ranging from driver-passenger matching, personalized recommendation, grouping of customers, related item recommendation, ranking recipients in an online charity platform, or even location-based search. In this particular talk, however, I'm going to focus on personalized recommendation, and either in the Q&A part or even afterwards, I'll be happy to discuss about the other kind of applications we have tried to incorporate fairness in. Now, coming to personalized recommendation, these are a critical component of many two-sided platforms, where the algorithms suggest relevant items to individual customers, such as which products to buy, which songs to listen to, which movies to watch, and so on. Since the item space in these platforms is kind of huge, the recommendations effectively determine the exposure for the producers. Like if we consider recommendation algorithm as a black box, this is roughly what goes into the recommendation pipeline. So essentially, when a customer comes, the recommendation algorithm looks at the history. History means like the browsing history or watching history or listening history of this particular customer, and also look at all the items which are there in the platform, and then recommend key items that would maximize customer satisfaction. Now, if we open up the black box a little bit, essentially there are two modules. One is relevance estimation module, and another is once the relevance is estimated, then you pick the K most relevant items and then recommend it to the customer. The job of this relevance estimation is to estimate personalized relevance of an item for a customer. And there are several techniques to do that. So one technique is content-based, where the algorithm looks at the type of items a customer has seen in the past and then tries to match it content-wise with other items which are there in the platform. And there are also another technique called collaborative filtering, where not only the history of this individual customer is taken into account, but also the history of other customers. And all this information feeds into the relevance estimation module. And then finally, using this relevance scores, the most relevant items are chosen. The point we are interested in, however, is what is the effect of such customer-centric design on the producers in two-sided platform. Now, to answer this, we gather two data sets. One is Google Local. So essentially, if you open Google Maps, you see a lot of local businesses nearby, and these local businesses can have different ratings given by the users. In fact, like any of us can actually go and rate or review a particular local business which is on Google Maps. Now, we collected data for about 855 local businesses in Manhattan, and the reviews or ratings given by more than 11,000 customers who are based in New York City. We also considered another data set from Last.fm. So this is a music streaming platform like Spotify, And we collected the number of times different artists in the platform were played by different listeners. And the data consists of more than 17,000 artists and about 2,000 listeners. And once these data sets are gathered, we then apply state-of-the-art personalized recommendation algorithm to recommend top K producers to every customer. Note that this is not a real setup. This is more like a simulated recommendation setup where we are generating the recommendations and then seeing how it would impact both customers and producers. Now, when we look at the producer side, essentially, we see that 20% of the businesses in Google Local can be recommended to 80% of the customers. Or like more technically, we can say that 20% of the businesses get 80% of total exposure, where exposure is determined by how many customers our business is being recommended to. And even in last FM, 60% artists who are like towards the bottom of the plot, they get only about 20% of total exposure, and rest 80% exposure is divided across 40% of the artists. So as you can see that there is quite high inequality in the amount of exposure different artists or businesses are getting. If everyone got almost equal amount of exposure, then the red line will actually coincide with the dotted green line here. But we can see in the plot that there is a quite a big gap between the two. Question is, why should we care for the producers? Because someone can say that, okay, ultimately the recommendation algorithm is trying to do what is best for the customers. So why should we even care to intervene? The fact is that a lot of small businesses and individuals, they depend on these online platforms for their livelihood. And this dependence has even increased quite a bit after the COVID pandemic hit us. Because for a lot of customers, now the online platforms are the go-to platform to do many of their day-to-day tasks and also to purchase or spend money on. And in fact, like, so at least I don't know the case about the e-commerce scenario in Australia, but in India, essentially Amazon and Flipkart are the two, almost it's like a duopoly between these two big platforms. And Indian regulation allows a particular e-commerce platform to only offer a marketplace model. So marketplace means that here the platform themselves cannot sell products. They just need to be a marketplace which facilitates sale between customers and producers or sellers on the marketplace. However, what is happening is that a lot of small sellers in these platforms, they regularly complain about being elbowed out in the e-commerce competition by bigger players or bigger sellers. And it's kind of important to note here is often these bigger sellers have some kind of relationship with the marketplace platform itself. So for example, sellers like Cloudtail and WS Retail, they are actually partially owned by Amazon and Flipkart respectively. So there is clearly like a conflict of interest which is going on, that Amazon and Flipkart, they own these two seller companies, and these sellers end up being the most like most sought after seller in the marketplace. Similar concern is also true for hotel business, online hotel booking. As this hotel aggregator platform called OYO, a lot of small hoteliers complain that OYO is biased towards bigger hotel chains and they give most of the sales to these bigger players and in the expense of this smaller hoteliers' revenue. Increasingly, there is also a push towards going to a fair marketplace. For example, like Government of India has recently released a national e-commerce policy, which categorically states that the e-commerce platform should be fair to all the sellers. They don't specify how should I mean, what this fairness means, or what should be the way to operationalize this fairness goal, but at least it's kind of clear that they want some kind of fairness in the marketplace. And recently, the state of California has passed this Assembly Bill 5 of gig worker bill, which says that the app-based platforms need to treat its employees or the gig workers as their employees. And immediately, as soon as you think about employment, you have to give a fair wage and other things. So there is clearly a legal push towards making the marketplace more fairer to the participants of that marketplace or different stakeholders of the marketplace. There are also business requirements to be fair to producers, because it would allow a platform to take new producers on board, and who are maybe equally good as more popular ones, and it would enable more choice for the customers with higher competition. Right? So the question is, what would be a producer-centric strategy in this case? Like, if we want to be fair to producers, what can be a way to be fair while recommending? One very easy approach, which we call as poorest K, is to recommend producers who are least exposed to customers in a round robin fashion. So it means that one customer comes, we look up the K least exposed producers so far, and then recommend those producers to the customer. And this would actually ensure that all the producers get almost equal amount of exposure. So you can possibly see the brown line, which is very close to the dotted green line, because here it is ensuring that almost all the producers are getting equal exposure. However, when we look at the utility of the customers or the satisfaction of the customers, the average satisfaction decreases a lot, because as you can imagine that now we are not thinking about the preferences of the customers and only recommending based on the producer welfare. And the bad thing is different customers can get affected to different degrees. Like, some customers may get recommendation which they like, whereas other customers may get recommendations which they absolutely do not like. So the takeaway is that we have to consider fairness for both sides when we think about developing a recommendation system. So towards that, we propose a two-sided fairness notion in recommendation, where in terms of fairness for producers, we propose to ensure a minimum exposure guarantee for every producer. So this notion of fairness is comparable to the fairness of universal basic income, that we want to ensure that every producer gets something. Like, no producer should starve for exposure. They should be getting some opportunity to showcase themselves in front of the customers. And when we talk about fairness for customers, we want the resultant utility loss. There are bound to be some loss, because if we think about top K recommendation, that is the best for customers. That is what, like, recommend what a customer is looking for or customer is most satisfied with. Now, immediately, if we go away from that top K recommendation, it may create some utility loss, but we want that utility loss to be fairly distributed among the customers. Now, the question is, in terms of the producer fairness, what would be a feasible minimum guarantee? And in terms of the customer fairness, the question is that what would be a fair distribution? Now, to answer these two questions, we reimagine fair recommendation as a fair allocation problem. Now, allocation, especially fairness in allocation, has been studied for quite some time in social choice theory, where people look at fair allocation of goods. So here you have a set of goods which you want to distribute or divide among a set of agents. The important thing to note here is that different agents may have different valuations over the set of goods, and these valuations are personalized. So for example, if you consider the red circle, a red ball, and consider the old man in the top, like, the that man is valuing the ball to be of value 4. Let's just imagine that these are an imaginary valuation function. But at the same time, the lady in the middle values the same red ball as 7. And the young person in the bottom row, like, he values the ball as 6. So as you can see, the same red ball can be perceived as of different value from different agents. And the goal, and given these valuations, the goal is to find a fair allocation. But again, the question is that what would be fairness in this context? So classically, there have been two notions of fairness which has been studied for divisible goods. And this problem is also known as cake cutting problem. That imagine that you have a cake and different parts of the cake consist of different ingredients. So suppose some part of the cake has chocolate, whereas other part of the cake has, say, vanilla cream, and some other part may consist of some other exotic fruits. Now, different people may have liking for these different portions of the cake. The question is that how can you cut the cakes such that people are kind of happy? So one notion is called envy freeness, where every agent values her piece of cake to be at least as valuable as anyone else's piece of cake. So suppose I am standing in a room with n other people, I look at my piece of cake and others' piece of cake in their hand, and I see that, okay, I mean, I got whatever I got is of more or equal value compared to anyone else's piece. Then that is envy-free solution, and I'm happy about it. There is another notion of fairness, and it's called proportional fair share. Now, it kind of says that, say, suppose I, as an agent, has a total valuation of the cake. Say, suppose I value the cake to be 100, and there are 10 people in the room. If I find that the value of my piece of cake is at least 10, that is like 100 divided by 10, then I am happy. So this is known as proportional fair share, that everyone values her share to be at least 1 by n time of the total value for all goods. However, when we think about recommendation, these notions may not be exactly achievable or may not be feasible to achieve. And there are reasons for it, that in case of cake, you can cut the cake as much or as many times as possible. Whereas in case of recommendation, you cannot half recommend or quarter recommend. I mean, it's like a binary setup. Either you recommend a product or you do not recommend. So we are into a domain of indivisible goods. And for indivisible goods, the corollary or the corresponding fairness notion to envy freeness is known as envy freeness up to one good. I'll explain what it is. And the corresponding notion to proportional fair share is maximin share. Now, for envy free up to one good is essentially, it is similar to envy free, except the fact that we are allowing one item to be there in someone else's bundle for which there can be envy. Say, again, just coming back to earlier example, say I am standing in a room, I have got some goods, and then I look at some other person and I found that I am okay with almost all the goods the other person has got, but there is one item in his or her hand for which I envy him or her. So that is a case where we call that this is a solution which is envy-free up to one good, because there is maximum one item for which there is envy. Now, if you consider in this example, the left-hand side box, so essentially the agent one has got these 3 items, whereas agent two has got these 2 items. Yet for agent one, the total value of the items which agent one has got is less than the value of the item agent two has got. Now, so in this case, there is envy, but as soon as you remove the black box, then there is no envy. So this original allocation is EF1. Now, regarding maximin share, let's just think about an interesting game. So suppose, so there is a supervisor and there are PhD students. Now the supervisor brings in some goods and asks one of the students to distribute the goods among themselves, or not distribute, like partition the goods into, say, n parts if there are n students, and then the supervisor is going to distribute. So note the thing that the person who is in charge of partitioning, that person is not going to distribute, it's the supervisor who is going to distribute. So then what happens is that the person who is dividing or partitioning the goods, in the worst case, that person will get the minimum valued partition, right? Like that person may be offered the chance to get a partition after everyone else. So if the person is rational, the person would like to maximize the value of this minimum valued good. And this whole value, like where there is a maximization of the minimum valued good, this is known as maximum share. And now it will be clear like why I talked about this NVP-ness up to one good and maximum share just in the next slide. So essentially just coming back to fair recommendation context. So essentially in this case, the products which we are going to recommend are the indivisible goods. The relevance scores the machine learning algorithm has computed are the valuations. And the customers whom we want to recommend are the agents. And essentially while doing so, we want to ensure that for producers, like every product, we want to guarantee a minimum amount of exposure, which is equal to alpha times that MMS, that maximum share threshold, where alpha can be a value between 0 to 1. And for the customer side, we want to ensure that the allocation is NP3 up to one good, as we discussed earlier. So in this case, say if there are, say, N products in the platform and there are M customers and every customer should be recommended K products, then essentially the exposure guarantee for producers become M cross K by N, where M cross K is total available exposure and N are the distinct products. So we want to provide every product this MMS threshold amount of exposure. Now, technically, the problem becomes a constraint satisfaction problem. Now, forget about the equation in the left side. Just focus on the text on the right. So essentially, we want to find product bundles to recommend. And there are three constraints. One is the exposure guarantee, that for every product, we want to ensure the MMS exposure threshold. Then there are EF1 guarantee, that for every customer, we want to ensure that the allocation is NP3 up to one good. And there is an additional cardinality constraint. This says that every customer should be recommended K products. Now in the paper, we propose an algorithm, FairRec, to solve this constraint satisfaction problem. Now immediately when we look at the effect of FairRec on the recommendations, or like we then simulate the recommendations with FairRec, and we can see that FairRec leads to much lower loss in customer utility compared to what poorest K was given. Like in this two plots, the green, the blue line shows that FairRec almost gives like almost equal to top K recommendation, the satisfaction what the customers would get. And when we look at the disparity among customer satisfaction, it's also quite low because here the standard deviation is close to zero. And in terms of the producers, it reduces inequality. Like it ensures that almost all producers are getting similar amount of exposure. Now, this is of course considering alpha is equal to one, where we want to ensure everyone MMS exposure. But for some platform, there can be different values of alpha, and then that will determine the inequality among the producers. Now, just going back to the recommendation pipeline, essentially we are trying to replace the bottommost module, where after relevance estimation, we want to deploy FairRec and then give the recommendation. And so the this kind of customization allows us to deploy FairRec pretty easily in already established machine learning models with already established machine learning models for relevance estimation. So this is kind of agnostic of the exact models which a particular company has deployed or developed for estimating relevance. Now, just to summarize, the key takeaways are that unlike the widely studied classification settings, like I was following the other talks in this seminar series, and most of the people have actually talked about this classification setting, where there is one decision maker and there is one like decision taker. And essentially this is like a classification decision, like either they select the person or reject the person, right? The setting which I describe and which is true in many other online platforms, that there are multiple stakeholders who have contrasting preferences. Like I talked about two sides, there can be even more than two sides. And when we try to maximize utilities for one side, there can be trade-offs. Like if we want to make it better or fairer for producers, it may actually impact the customers and it may make it unfair for the customer. So the important takeaway is that we have to consider notions of two-sided fairness in such settings, like where we need to be fair to both sides and appear at some kind of a compromise. In today's talk, we discuss such notions and how to achieve them in personalized recommendations. But not only recommendations, any information access algorithms in these platforms, they essentially distribute opportunities, right? So the key question which we are going after and which I would be open to discuss more is how to distribute such kind of opportunities justly among all the stakeholders. And with that note, thank you. And I'll be happy to take any questions which you may have.
Thank you so much, Abhi. That was just beautifully clear and really interesting. Thank you very much. Okay, so we're going to do the Q&A now. I'll field the questions. So folks who are on the call here on the panel, if you raise your hands, as Lixing and Weiwen have done, that would be great. And then if you're in the broader audience, if you'd like to write your question down in the Q&A, then I will get to it there. And also, of course, as usual, we've opened up a Slack channel on our Slack. Hopefully, Michael will post a link in the chat in just a moment for anybody who hasn't joined it yet. So Weiwen had a question sort of partway through. So I'll start with you, Weiwen, if you'd like to ask a question.
Yeah, thanks. So actually, I have read your triple W paper, the FairRec one. And what I was doing before is closely related to your work. And I have been work with Professor Robin Berg, and we work on the multi-stakeholder, fairness-aware multi-stakeholder recommender systems. And I really like your idea that you consider both producer and consumer side fairness at the same time. But I have two questions. First one is that your work is based on the assumption that the customer utility or the relevance score is perfectly estimated or accurately given. In real world applications, such value is estimated by a machine learning algorithm, say collaborative filtering. So it may contain noise and may be noisy. So if the utility value is noisy, then our evaluation of the customer fairness would also contain noise. So how can we deal with that? And what if we cannot obtain the accurate utility value?
Now, this is a great question. And yes, like you were correct that we didn't consider the fairness in the estimation, the relevance estimation module itself, right? And there can be differences in the amount of accuracy with which you can estimate relevance for different customers. So and this is kind of more true when you have a disparity in the amount of data for different customers. Like you may predict it much better if you know more about a customer compared to another. We didn't look at that, but I have come across some works which specifically focus on collaborative filtering and how can you make collaborative filtering algorithms more fair, right? And most of these works, what do? that essentially you have in the relevance estimation model, you essentially try to minimize the error in prediction based on the past data of that particular customer. And in addition to that, if you add some additional constraints where you say that, oh, you don't want to be much like this much oats for one group of customers versus another group of customers, those kind of fine tunings are providing some kind of a constrained optimization setup can give you some or can lead to some kind of fairness. But yes, like this is not solved yet. And this is a challenging problem. Yeah. And I know like Professor Book is also working on some of these algorithms that I have also looked at. So possibly I'll look up some of your works as well.
Thanks, that's really helpful. And my second question is that, as we all know, the main task of recommender system is to recommend the most relevant items to the users. So considering fairness will definitely affect user utility or user preference. So what's your opinion on the trade-off between user utility and producer fairness?
Yes, this is interesting because what we did here, like that is why like I stressed on the fact that we are trying to ensure NVP up to one good. So we are saying that suppose you have 10 products to recommend, we try to ensure that 9 of them are kind of more organic, that we try to give you 9 items which you like best. But there will be one item for which we we try to take away that one item from you and replace it with another item which would ensure fairness for the producer. And that is why like so if you can see the slide here, so essentially like we see that this blue line is kind of close to what you would get with a top K recommendation. And the main reason is that like we provide almost similar just beside one item kind of.
Oh, okay. All right, thanks.
Yeah, nice questions. Thanks.
Yes, so the next question was going to come from Lexing, who also has a comment on this question. So Lexing, if you'd like to ask your two questions.
Thanks for the talk. I think the problem setting is very fresh and interesting. My question is related to your description just now. You say if I'm going to recommend you 10 items, and essentially 9 of them will be of the highest preference. So can I take this as an interpretation of the underlying algorithm and also connection to collaborative filtering algorithms? Like, constraint optimization problem actually doing this, or is there a way to interpret that like this?
So in this case, like I didn't exactly go to the collaborative filtering algorithm. Like, so collaborative filtering is used for relevance estimation, which we are not touching. So we are assuming whatever is being output by collaborative filtering is to be the true relevance scores, or this denotes the true preference of the customer. But after that, unfortunately, I didn't have time to go into the actual algorithm. Like in the algorithm, we are like trying to ensure that we recommend most of the things from the most relevant item list and just take 1 or 2 items from from some other items where which would allow us to be more fair to the producer. So I should just correct a little bit. It's not as straightforward as just say taking the top 9 items fixed and then like the last one we just try to manipulate or try to just replace with some other item. Like there is an involved algorithm going on which tries to find the items which can be replaced or which can be put into the recommendation bundle. And in general, one thing is this NVP notion is it doesn't actually tell you anything about the absolute value of that particular item or the relevance value of that item. It just says that it's like more like a relative term. Like if you look at another customer and look at the recommendation what that other customer has got, you should not be envious of that person except one item. So that allows us some kind of a leeway, like trying to make sure that we are fair to the producer.
Thank you for this discussion. So am I correct in saying that the constraint satisfaction problem you presented a few slides ago was essentially running collaborative filtering as a utility estimate, right? And then instead of taking top K, run this, right? And if you remove the exposure guarantee constraint, then it will essentially boil down to taking the top K.
Yes, right. Because as soon as you remove that exposure guarantee, then we will ensure NV free for everyone. And that would be like the best possible in terms of the performance, right? Like the customers will be best satisfied if they get whatever they want. Essentially, the exposure guarantee, that constraint is kind of putting us in a constraint space where we have to find like a solution which also guarantees NV free up to one good.
Nishin, can I just jump in with a finger on this question? So, look, obviously, I'm sure that you could express this constraint satisfaction problem with a range of different, if you like, distributive criteria, sort of distributive principles. And I think it'd be really interesting to sort of explore which ones you looked at and you know, how you settled on this one. But just specifically to this point about this sort of a minimum constraint. So another general kind of requirement of fairness is, if you like, that it be sensitive to people's efforts. So suppose you're one producer and you've worked really hard to make sure that you're going to appeal to the local, you know, the local community. You know, you've done loads of stuff to it. And then there's another one who's just like, hasn't done anything, don't really care, very lazy, they've put their ad up. And this is the same sort of principle that applies in distributive justice questions more generally. And so I'm curious about about why you think that sort of it's important to give this exposure guarantee that isn't sensitive to the efforts that are put in by the producers.
This is a great question. And actually our algorithm, like I discussed it, I didn't want to go into that detail in the talk, but actually in the algorithm, we can tune the parameter alpha. Like just see that there is in the exposure guarantee, we don't say just MMS, we have a value of alpha. Either you can keep the alpha same for everyone. Like for every producer, you want to exactly guarantee the same amount of exposure. Or else you can have this alpha vary based on the effort that the producers are providing. So essentially, then it would lead to higher amount of inequality, but that inequality will be justified by this effort-based notion, right? Like you can just say that this alpha or the exposure you want to provide to different producers are just proportional to the effort they are putting. So we have allowed, at least that is allowed. But of course, there are other notions of like distributive justice, which we may not be accounting for. And that is why I actually ended up with this question, that the key question is how to distribute this kind of opportunities justly. And there a lot of such principles can be invoked. And just one point I want to mention here is that oftentimes we computer scientists tend to pick some notion which is easily operationalizable and which can be encoded in a more formal way so that like we can now feed it to like either a constraint optimization solver, like we can just take it and put it and give it to a solver, or we can try to actually come up with some more efficient algorithms, right? So, and to think about what kind of distributive justice principles in fact can be operationalized and can be mapped to a more formal definition is something which I'll be looking forward to. So like I'll be happy to continue this discussion even later or even like sometime later, but I am kind of curious to know that in which context, which kind of principle actually hold, like which holds for an e-commerce platform may not be same or may not hold for, say, a music streaming platform, because the whole context may be very different and we may need to think a little more about those things.
Yeah, fantastic. Well, this is definitely the right group of people to be talking to about that. So, Michael, would you like to ask your question?
Yeah, thanks. And thanks for such a clear and you covered so many concepts in this talk. It was fantastic. I have a thought, which is, how would you characterize the difference between like this, I guess, static recommendation system and something that's more like a banded solution to this type of problem? And I wonder if like the banded solution would maybe somewhat naturally like handle some of the, not necessarily, but could address some of the exposure problems, especially if, like you suggested earlier, some of the problems are due to the high uncertainty for certain like relevance estimates, right? A banded framework would make that explicit and then like try to target that,
Yes. That is correct. In fact, like we are now trying to work on a bandit setup with the same kind of goal. Like, how can you ensure that every producer, or effectively it's like every product is being part of that exploration phase at least some minimum amount of time? And just guaranteeing that would actually ensure that we provide some guaranteed exposure for everyone. So we are looking at that, and that is an important point you make, and that might help us also circumvent some of the problems with the collaborative filtering methodology. That is correct.
Thanks.
Thanks, Michael. I'm going to come back to distributive justice in a minute, but Le Xing, if you wanted to ask your other question.
I guess I'm just going to ask about the algorithm a bit more. So you said there is a polynomial time algorithm to solve this allocation problem. Is that the optimal and where is the limit in these, I guess, social allocation algorithms that I admit that I'm not familiar with them. So does it find a good solution? Does it find the best solution? Okay.
So let me just give me 1 minute. I'll just pull up the slides for the algorithms, I think, and it would just help me to answer your question. So essentially, can you see the slide?
I'm on this.
Okay. We're still on the same window as before.
Can you see now? Okay.
We're on ensuring two-sided fairness now.
Yes. So essentially, this is the algorithm. Like FairRec is, so it's a two-phase algorithm. Like in the first phase, we want to ensure the guaranteed exposure for producers while maintaining EF1 for customers. And then in the next phase, we continue allocation until all the customers get exactly K products. Let me just give you one example, like how it works. So suppose we have to recommend 5 products. There are 5 products to 7 customers, and every customer should be recommended 3 products. And the exposure guarantee we provide is, say, every product should be recommended to 2 customers. Now, what we do is just we take this number 2, like what is this exposure guarantee? We create 2 copies of each product and then allocate all these products to the customers. Now, the question is that how should we ensure EF1 for customers? We essentially allocate in a greedy round robin manner, that suppose we look at the preference of the, say we ordered the customers, it's like an arbitrary order, but we pick the first customer and allocate the product which this customer likes most. Then we go to the next customer we again allocate the product which this customer likes most. But then if this, we continue doing that, but at some point we may find a situation where we try to allocate a product which is not available. Like we have already allocated to enough customers. So then we go to its next preference. And that is how the whole algorithm kind of proceeds. So essentially we keep in mind these two constraints. One is availability constraint, another is feasibility constraint, that one customer cannot be allocated the same product more than once. I mean, here when I'm talking about allocated, it's like recommended kind of. Now, say suppose this first phase ends and trained products are allocated to 7 customers and greedy roundable leaves each customer with either one product or 2 products. Now, we still have to allocate until everyone gets 3 products. So in phase 2, what we do is we make every product infinitely available. And this can include the products which earlier we couldn't allocate. And then we continue doing this greedy round robin. And the interesting thing is that this particular phase actually allows us to make sure that the utility or the satisfaction of the customers is as close as the top K thing as possible. So essentially, this is the kind of algorithm. And in terms of the theoretical guarantees, we ensure EF1 fairness for all the customers. And when let's take the value of alpha to be 1, we ensure MMS exposure for at least N minus K producer, where N is the number of producers and K is the recommendation size. Like say, suppose if there are 100 producers and 10 items to recommend, then essentially we'll ensure that we provide MMS exposure for at least 90 producers. But in practice, like N is much larger than K, so we almost cover everyone. And the worst case runtime bound is order of M cross N cross K, like which might be large like to look at, but it turns out that we can run this in batches. Like maybe the platform may run it every 5-minute window and just consider all the customers which have arrived in that 5 minutes. So that way we can make the value of M lower. K is anyway low, so it only depends on the number of items in the marketplace.
Thanks, that helped.
That was really fascinating. So look, I have a few additional questions. I don't know if there'll be time for them, but I can put some into the Slack afterwards. But I was thinking about, so in any sort of problem of distributive justice, there's this question of like, you know, what's the thing that you're distributing? And is the thing that you're distributing the thing that really matters, right? So if you equally distribute resources like money, say, to a population, and the population has different needs, like someone needs to have, you know, extensive modifications to their home in order to accommodate their disability, then you're not going to be getting equality of outcome, even though you're giving everyone the same kind of resources. So I was thinking about the two things that you're distributing. On the one hand, there's exposures, and on the other hand, there's utility. And so I wanted to just sort of press and think a bit about whether those are the things that really matter. So for example, if I'm a business in this situation, I guess, you know, I want exposures, but I only want them as a means to an end. And what I really want is exposure to customers who are likely to click. So if I'm getting the sort of, the guarantee fulfilling kind of token exposure to someone who's very unlikely to click on me, then that it might still be the case that that fair rec leads to some producers getting way better actual sales, like the outcomes that they really care about, and than others because of the way the algorithm is working. So yes. how do you think about that?
That is correct. So one thing which we have, so again, just coming back to this thing that ultimately we are talking about recommendation in this case, right? Now, either we can view this as an allocation problem, that is essentially as if you are allocating the products to customers, or else we can view this as a matching problem where you essentially match producers with customers. Now, in case of matching problem, you tend to deal with preferences from both sides. Like in this case, we are kind of assuming that producers are happy as long as they're being exposed. So there is no absolute preference over the customer. But we can bring in this aspect that the producers may, like you can have the customers and the you can know the likelihood of a particular customer clicking on a product. And based on that, you can compute the preference on the producer side. And of course, the relevance estimation module is going to give you the preference on the customer side. And then basically, you need to think about how to match and try to be fair in the matching process. Yeah. So it's just like technically, it maps to another problem. But of course, conceptually, we have to think more about exactly what opportunity you want to distribute. Like, is it just about exposure or it's more like the probability of sale?
Yeah, that's fantastic. Look, I would love to continue this conversation. And yes. It's 6 o'clock here, so I think folks may be a bit slow to get on the Slack and might pick it up tomorrow, because I'm sure everyone's as hungry for their dinner as I am. But thank you so much, Abhi, for the talk. It was really great, and I hope we'll continue to keep this conversation going over the next weeks and months.
Yes,